What I thought I would do is introduce you to something called non-standard aesthetics. And this is something that has been the topic of my research for about 4 or 5 years. And it's culminated in a number of books. And I still feel like I'm just on the cusp of sort of understanding what this entails. The person who coined this phrase or this term non-standard aesthetics is pictured here. He is the French contemporary theorist François Laruelle, and he's this project of non-standard aesthetics is part of a larger intellectual project which he initially called non-philosophy, and that caused him a lot of confusion, and then he later termed it non-standard philosophy, which is still a bit confusing, but less so, I think. What is then non-standard philosophy in a nutshell? I'll try to explain that, but I'll try to do that by really focusing on what its implications, at least the implications I think it has for the practices of art history, perhaps art theory, criticism, et cetera. So hopefully through kind of localizing it in those branches, we get a better sense of the larger project he's been engaged in now for about 40 years. He's in his upper 80s now. The two books that he wrote on, aesthetics on, are in these two books here. These are just the covers of the books. Not the most exciting covers, but there they are. One is called The Concept of Non-Photography, as you can see, and the other one is called Photo Fiction. And the concept of fiction is not something I'm going to get into tonight, but it has a particular role to play in how he conceives of what he calls non-standard aesthetics. And very important for his work has been a focus on photography. And that's really been his kind of way of developing this theoretical framework. But it has implications for media beyond photography. So what, in sort of broad strokes, is non-standard philosophy about? I think the easiest way to put it would be to say that Laruelle says that, let's say, take aesthetics as our example, that say in philosophical aesthetics, but it could be applied to other branches of philosophical study, epistemology, political philosophy, et cetera. But in the realm of philosophical aesthetics, where questions of what is beauty, what is art, how do we judge its quality or not, what is its meaning for us, that he says traditionally, in what he would call standard philosophy, the presumption has been that somehow philosophy can sort of capture in some measure the essence of what, say, art is. Now, there's certainly plenty of approaches in contemporary aesthetic philosophy that take a non-essentialist concept of art as a given. So in that sense, it's nothing particularly new. But what is new is that Laruelle doesn't even want to make an anti-essentialist philosophical aesthetics, he doesn't want to turn that into a foundation either. He wants to kind of suspend the whole question of whether or not there's an essence to art or there's no essence to art and try to do something very different about the relationship between philosophy and art. And I'll just put this in a nutshell and then I'll try to work this out, and I've got some prepared notes. The nutshell version is, one of the things he's frustrated by is that he thinks that also philosophical aesthetics, but in some measure he thinks art history, sort of presumes that it can sort of exchange the concepts it uses to talk about or discuss or discourse art with art itself. So that ends up being a kind of conflation between how we conceptualize art and, as it were, the materiality of art itself. And I'll give you a kind of practical example that's, I think, kind of humorous, kind of gets into this. I once took many art history classes, but in one of them, I took an art history class in modern art long ago. And after it was all over, or the last day, my professor said to me, or said to the class, "Oh, just so you know, this has not been a class in painting or sculpture. Empirically speaking, this has only been a class in photography, because that's precisely what we were looking at." Now that sort of sparked my thinking way back during my master's degree that was sort of interesting, that if we started to think about how something that we take for granted, that we can use photographic reproductions in photography in art history courses as we do. We take for granted that when we point to the screen and we say, ah, there's a Picasso, we don't say, of course, there's a photograph of a Picasso on the screen. And that began to make me think about the ways in which also, not only does reproduction, I think, fundamentally alter how we see art, but if we extend that, we could also say that that forms of conceptual reproduction sharply frame how we understand art. So what's on the screen is one way of framing it, but we also, of course, frame art in words, in concepts, in strategies of periodization, style analysis, iconology, et cetera. So that kind of led me into Laruelle, because he takes this question of conceptual reproduction very seriously. So let me just pick this up. He develops this idea in relationship to photography. But I'll just start off by saying this. When we historicize art or critique or theorize it, we are engaged in acts of conceptual reproduction. We kind of reproduce the work through our terms. We conceptually reproduce the work in the form of words, concepts, and arguments. And typically, we don't give this operation much thought, except when we take issue with a given interpretation, or like in that class when my prof said these were all photographs. So for Laruelle, the matter and the problem of reproduction, even conceptual reproduction, is visible in photography in a kind of stressed or symptomatic way. Since its origins, photography has been very concerned about the relation between photographic representation and reality as such. We know, of course, that photography can reproduce the image of the visible world, and that's important, I think, to defend, because particularly in the case of documentary imagery. But we also recognize that an image as image is also materially distinct from the reality of the reference pictured in the photograph, right? There's still a difference between the image as image and the reality as such. So photography has been very concerned about this relationship between reproduction and reality. And Laruelle then applies that to philosophy. So the question for him, and I suppose for my own work, has been, what happens if we as art historians and theorists take seriously this difference between conceptual reproduction and the work of art in its material distinction? What happens if we become more conscious and more critical about the ways in which we reproduce works of art and how those reproductions, those conceptual reproductions, guide and underpin our historical and theoretical work? We know, of course, that it does matter because, among other things, there's a history to art history, right? We don't do the way art history today, of course, the way that, say, Vasari in the Renaissance did it, right? So we conceptually use different concepts. That in some sense means we reproduce art differently. And we might even call these conceptual, these forms of conceptual reproduction technologies of reproduction. A concept is in some sense a tool. Term concept in German is Begriff, which means to grasp. It's like a tool for getting hold of something. So we might think of it in some very broad sense as a kind of technology. And in the practice of art history, for sure, some of these concepts that we are accustomed to using are things like periodization, it's like a term like the Renaissance, style, like mannerism. We might have recourse to other discursive frames, such as biography, formal analysis. I'm sure you have experiences, maybe unpleasant ones with formal analysis, I don't know. Formal analysis, cultural analysis, iconography, iconology, etc. These are different technologies, as it were. I don't mean to suggest that there has been no attention paid to these matters in our history up to this point. Certainly not. There's lots of very interesting critical work in historiography, study of how we do history, which is key. But I do think that Laruelle's work pushes this to a considerable extent, and it gives us the opportunity to develop sort of the theoretical implications of this in interesting ways that I don't think have been done up to this point. And what is the way what is the sort of unique difference it makes? Well, in a nutshell, this. One of the things that frustrates Laruelle about conceptual reproduction of works of art is that oftentimes, not always, but oftentimes you end up with a kind of division of labor and a hierarchy that ensues. So in some sense, often traditionally we sort of approach an artwork conceptually, and the artwork ends up being a kind of dumb or inert object. And all the meaning is on our side, how we historicize it, how we theorize it, how we interpret it. And in that sense, as it were, theory or history or criticism, in effect, always has the last word, and the artwork is sort of left in a kind of subordinate position. And so in the traditional frame, Laruelle says, often what happens is art becomes an object of analysis only. And what he wants to do, and he tries to suggest ways of doing this, is to see if we could sort of invert that relationship. So that rather than the artwork being simply a kind of inert, mute object of analysis, what if the artwork became a kind of point of departure for philosophy? So rather than having a philosophy of art, where philosophy tells us what art is or a specific artwork means, what would happen if a given work of art or set of art, works of art, became a point of departure for doing philosophical work? So it kind of reverses it. And if you like, it would be sort of like, and I'll just sort of wave this as a magic wand, it would be something like, rather than a philosophy of, say, abstract expressionism, what would be an abstract expressionist philosophy? That's the sort of move he's going to try to make. The other thing he's trying to challenge in inverting that traditional hierarchy is to also challenge this division of labor, which we might understand as a division of labor in which artists make and theorists and historians and critics explain. So we end up with this kind of division of labor. Artists make stuff, but we historians tell the world what that stuff is or means. And he wants to also challenge that and say, we should maybe think also of artists as active participants in the history of intellectual life or of intellectual production. So the explication of art, whether by means of historicization, critique, or theorization, conceptually reproduces the work of art as a mere object. It subordinates its alterity to an explanatory discourse. And this is what, again, Laruelle wants to contest. Now, my own work has attempted to develop this idea of inverting this relationship between art and theory or art and history, mostly art and theory, through the study of a number of artists. Oh yeah, so I'm plugging my book, there you go. But for one artist is Anish Kapoor. And in the book, Laruelle and Art, I tried to kind of think about what would it mean to at least even begin asking questions within this framework in which art isn't just an object of analysis, but is a point of departure for philosophy itself. In my work, for example, I've tried most recently to re-examine the sculpture of Anish Kapoor, Dan Flavin, and the installation art of James Turrell. And I'm not sure how familiar you are with these individuals, but I had to show you this photograph of one of James Turrell's installations, because they're so difficult to actually reproduce. I actually went to this installation that the woman pictured in this photograph is experiencing, and you literally go into this semi-darkened room, and I know it looks like a computer-generated image, but it's not. You go into this room, and it looks like there's a cube, a blue cube just floating in the air, but it's actually all crafted through light. It's by refracting light in a particular way relative to the interior lighting produces the illusion of a three-dimensional object. But if you were to put your hand out, it just go through the blue light. I had a photograph of this with ducks passing by the mirror and I thought it was great, but anyway. So on my reading, the work of these artists and others can be fruitfully redeployed for rethinking the philosophy itself as a practice of aesthetics. So rather than think about using philosophical aesthetics to analyze these works, I want to think about how these works might actually enable philosophy to consider its own aesthetic choices with respect to things like word construction, phraseology, and other semantic devices. So let me throw out some questions that I tried to broach in this book in relationship to these works using this non-standard approach. Schematically, we might ask things like, In Kapoor's reflective surfaces, like the sky mirror here in Kensington, such a work redoubles the materiality and metaphoricity of reflection itself. It might then cause philosophy to consider what aesthetics underpin its operations of reflection. What does it reflect? How does it do that work? How does it frame what it reflects, rather than try to determine the meaning of this work? What does it mean then also to reflect on a work of art like Kapoor's that has already and self-critically literally taken up the matter and the metaphor of reflection itself? What does it mean then to reproduce in words the art of visual reproduction embodied already in works like Sky Mirror? Similarly, how might this, as a work by Dan Flavin called Homage to Vladimir Tatlin, the Russian constructivist. A lot of Flavin's work is about a kind of historicization work. He's kind of culling through art history's past and then reframing it. How might Flavin's homages to art history's past, such as the constructivist movement indexed here, already take the matter of historicization as one of its key concepts? It tells us already that the matter of historicization is not simply and solely a practice of history. It is itself a practice already within certain forms of art practice. What does it mean that in Terrell's work, which Laruelle himself has written on, it's one of the few artists he's actually written about, what does it mean that this work is already taking the question of perception into its very materiality? And it's already a kind of critical interrogation of optical perception itself. It means, among other things, that for these artists, we can ask, how do they rethink and materially remodel basic philosophical concepts such as reflection in Kapoor, history in Flavin, perception in Terrell? Very key concepts in art history, but they're already sort of imminently within the works themselves. Rather than treat works by these artists as mere objects of analysis, I tried to show in my book how such works offer interesting starting points for philosophical thought on the matters of reflection, history, and perception, and the way in which those matters are underwritten by aesthetic practices regarding things like word choice, phraseological construction, etc. That is, I tried to show that the work can be treated not simply as a dumb, inert set of dead objects, but as a living thought that can be developed by philosophy without being simply an object of analysis. In this, my work in the field of intellectual history, broadly construed, has attempted to show how this conception, and I'm wrapping up here, of Laruelle's non-standard aesthetic program illuminates what it shares with similar attempts to break the division of labor between artists and theorists slash historians, and to forestall the hierarchy of judgment that seems always to give the last word to theory or history or criticism at the expense of the work itself. Last point, my experience as a teacher of art history has been influential in my development of this project. My early approach to teaching illuminated the fact, at least my experience of it, that oftentimes students, particularly art students, whom I teach quite, the majority of my students are art students, could often feel excluded or intimidated by theory and feel like they didn't have an intellectual role to play in the art history classroom. They sort of saw works of art being analyzed and they thought, well, I make works of art, but I guess I'm not really in the business of analysis. And I think this approach tries to say, to invert that division of labor, or that hierarchy at least, and say we should actually take seriously the intellectual labor of art. This typical approach in which sort of history or theory has the last word on art fails to account, I think, again, for this, the intellectual import of art itself. When, however, we take this non-standard approach, which I've only schematically broached tonight, we can begin to see that art, the art history classroom, can be refunctioned to work no longer as a space in which the visual submits to the logic of the verbal, where the visual is there and the meaning comes through the verbal, but as a space in which precisely the visual and the verbal are allowed to retain their relative autonomy, even as they enter into dialogical relation.
I find it interesting, but I don't know, like, it seems like you have quite the mountain to climb, and maybe Laruelle does too. And you kind of mentioned it. It's like, I wonder if, like, would you say that, you know, maybe that's off the on the wrong track, but like, you're saying that, well, the art should speak for itself, essentially. It doesn't need the dialogue that we tend to add to it. And I guess that, at least with our traditional way of education, it might be hard to consider any other way to do it, especially in the classroom. But do you think like the artists necessarily need to like write a manifesto for about it? Because I mean, I know some movements did that, and maybe it helps narrow down what they're trying to get at. Or like, in a way, I guess, how does the subjectivity come into it? Like,
Those are great questions, actually. And so to your first question, yes, this is extremely difficult to practice in the classroom. And so 99 times out of 100, I am doing it much more in the traditional way in which I'm sure you folks are used to in your history classroom. I tend to broach non-standard aesthetics. I've only begun just to begin to teaching it in theory classes, as teaching it as a framework that's available for students to think about. But certainly to how you would actually, you know, teach from the standpoint is very, very hard. So I would want to say, I guess, one other thing about that, which is there is a huge mountain to climb. And he's been climbing it for 40 years. And by the way, he himself kind of gives a kind of meta theory of it. In other words, he says, yes, we should do this kind of work in which we let sort of art be, or rather, we let it influence philosophy rather than become an object of only a philosophical analysis. The broadest sense could be history, criticism, theory. He himself doesn't exactly show what it would look like to do this. He kind of gives a framework for saying this would be an interesting thing to try. So it is a mountain to climb, and in some sense, he hasn't even begun it. He sort of suggested there's a mountain out there to climb. He's sort of done the scouted it, but from a distance. So, to the point of art speaking for itself, not quite that it would just sort of speak for itself, because in some sense that phrase, like it speaks for itself, always sort of ends up that we end up speaking anyway for it, because it never does speak for it. I mean, it rarely speaks for itself. Some things are very obvious, but a lot of it isn't. So again, I think the best way to understand this project is, how do you invert that hierarchy and say, how does Terrell's, for example, Terrell's investigations of perception, how might that actually help to reframe philosophies of perception? So Terrell won't be an example of the philosophy of perception. He won't be an object of analysis under, say, phenomenology, but rather would actually be like, what is a Terrellian philosophy rather than a philosophy of Terrell's work? And I would say too that this project does have affinities with other theoretical frameworks, and I'm happy to talk about this, but I mean, just to throw out one name, I think it has a lot of affinities with the work of Theodor Adorno in his aesthetics. And a lot of what Adorno was interested in doing was a sort of thinking about art as already sort of imminently an intellectual force and not only an object of intellectual work. Now, for example, Adorno has a book called Philosophy of Modern Music. And in that book, what he tried to do was to say, I'm not going to give you the meaning of modernist music like Schoenberg. What I'm going to try to do is to develop a kind of philosophy that's Schoenbergian, that would be based, for example, on things like non-resolution. So in Schoenberg's music, he avoids things like resolution. Well, what would it look like if a philosophical argument was structured with that in mind, that doesn't try to aim for resolution, but keeps things in tension? So he is, I think Laruelle has some affinities with work like that.
Between these three artists you pointed out, I'm most acquainted with Dan Flavin. Mm-hmm. And you were talking about how he's pretty much responding to art history, or at least what we consider art history. Mm-hmm. But I also know that, well, I don't know the context super well, but I know he's known for saying like, what's there is there and it's nothing else. And is that him trying to get rid of the dialogue pretty much? Like,
yeah, I'm not familiar with that quote, but you know, he's a And now I'll put on my art history cap for a minute and say he's in some measure a product of the 60s moment in Western art broadly conceived, which was you have statements like that from a number of artists in the 60s, like John Cage. John Cage famously said, "I have nothing to say, and I'm saying that." There's a lot of sort of formulations like that in 60s art. And certainly there's a wonderful book by Carter Ratcliffe called Out of the Box, which is about post-minimalism, and a lot of that deals with Dan Flavin and many other people. But Ratcliffe uses the term apodictic to describe the work of Flavin. Or Flavin said, like, it's there. It's sort of emphatically there. Those are fluorescent tubes. He doesn't disguise that. They're lit up. That's what it is. It is what it is. Except, and this is what I get into my book, if that's all that there is here, that's still quite a bit particularly in terms of the conceptual framework in which sculpture was constructed in the 60s. There's the question of how he's bringing in the ready-made concept there and so forth. But his titling is fascinating. So for this one, it's homage to, it's the number of, there's like seven of these, but this is homage to V. Totman, and Vladimir Totman, the early 20th century Russian avant-garde constructivist artist. And actually, it's a reference particularly to Totman's most famous work of art, which was the Monument to the Third International. You can Google it. But that's his most famous work. But what's interesting is, rather than say homage to the third Monument to the Third International, he displaces the name of the object for the name of the artist. And so instead of monument, homage to the Third International, it becomes homage to the artist. And so in my book, I try to think about what's the sort of the conceptual import of this shift in attention in the titling from the object is, because the Third International has this kind of tower-like form, and he's sort of schematically suggesting it here. And yet the name that appears in the title is Totman. So what does it mean about where the object is schematically referenced, but the title bears the name? And so I try to kind of work out, try to develop what would it then mean for the practice of philosophy to sort of think in terms of names as well as sort of schematic objects. I mean, for example, a lot of people will use terms like in philosophy, like that's very Platonic, that's Spinozist, or that's right. And so the question of names and how names come to stand for entire forms of thought is something I think is sort of similar about philosophy and art history. Right, there's a way in which the name often sort of, so Picasso stands in for cubism. Right? So try to kind of think about what's going on in that substitution.
Would you say that this approach of non-standard philosophy, do you think that it applies more effectively to modern and postmodern art? Or if not, what's an example of how you could get this same kind of fountain of philosophy from something from, say, a Renaissance or pre-Renaissance period?
That's a great question, Zane. Yeah, so Laruelle himself has written very little on particular works of art. He did write on James Turrell, which he's fascinated by. So in his work, and he's written on photography, but in a kind of general sense, which is sort of photography generally. So and then in my work and the work of other people that are trying to develop Laruelle's work, the tendency has been to work within the modern, postmodern framework or the periods. I think it would be an interesting experiment, though, to see how you might develop a non-standard philosophy through the, as it were, the lens of say, Renaissance art. I don't know anybody who's done it. I will say this, Dane, and I think this, you point out something that's important, which is that I think, and if you pick up a book by Laruelle, you'll see this. He is a relentlessly non-visual, non-figurative thinker. And that sounds paradoxical because he's interested in art. But he kind of gets back to my earlier point. He's very cautious about getting involved in these modes of conceptual reproduction, like, oh, I'm just talking about Picasso, and then suddenly we've conflated my talking of Picasso with the Picasso on the wall. So to avoid that kind of slip, he tends to work in a relentlessly non-visual register in his writing. And so I think that degree of abstraction in his work lends itself more easily to very abstract, non-figurative work. Whereas I think with, say, Renaissance art, because it's figurative and very much laden with story and symbolic significance, that disjunct between that heavy visuality in Renaissance art and then sort of non-visual character of his theory might be a difficult disjunct to square. But I would say also that Laruelle is always, he's very much interested in non-standard philosophy as a mode of experimental philosophy. So he would probably be interested in such an experiment, though he hasn't himself tried it.
Where do you think that he got that specific term of non-philosophy or non-standard philosophy? Why do you think that this departs that significantly from all of these other approaches that have developed through the millennia?
Yeah, no, that's a great question, Dean. And this is one of the things that, so one of the things that Laruelle has been consistently criticized for, and I think with some justice, is to your point. In my own work, I've tried to show actually where the affinities are between Laruelle's work and a number of other philosophers and theorists. So I have a book coming out this summer in which I look at a number of theorists, including Theodore Adorno and others, who are doing something different, but there's clearly affinities. On the surface, it's not necessarily entirely, I would say on the surface, and even Laruelle would say this, on the surface, if you read a book by Laruelle, it will read a lot like philosophy, and actually it will read like some of the most abstract and abstruse philosophy you've ever read. It's that his starting points are, I think, novel and different. And this would get us into a bit of some technical weeds, but I'll just sort of put it out like this. He does have some axioms that structure his project. So his project of non-standard philosophy is guided by a number of axioms. One of them is this axiom that what he calls standard philosophy is marked, axiomatically insists that it is identified with a gesture he calls philosophical decision, and he always capitalizes these terms. What he means by decision is something like the decision on what reality is, or what its essence is, or what's really important about reality. And he says, concomitant with that decision is, he says, a presupposition that in his view goes unquestioned. Presupposition being that philosophy has the conceptual resources necessary to render such a decision. So whether that's Plato says, you know, what's real in some final sense is the forms, the world of absolute truths, or in Hegel, the kind of the absolute end of history, even in sort of anti-foundationalist philosophies, and I'll just use these kind of terms like Foucault, it might be discourse, Derrida, it might be difference with an A. And he would claim that all of these are decisions that sort of structure the identity of philosophy. In non-standard philosophy, he says, we're going to suspend the idea that philosophy has or will ever have the requisite resources to render a decision on what he calls the real. Another good example would be Heidegger, sort of the notion of the real is being, capital B. That would be for him a kind of exemplary case of a decision in philosophy. His whole process, and in philosophical aesthetics, decisions like what is art? Art is X. Or even in anti-foundationalist aesthetics, like art doesn't have a foundation, but then that sort of becomes a foundation as well. So his sort of move is to say, let's bracket that and suspend that decision. And then what happens is he actually then will use what he calls philosophical materials. He uses all the materials of philosophy, all the concepts through millennia, but not in order to make sort of final decisions about the nature of art or the nature of reality. And he thinks that some of these questions, say the nature of reality, are better left to other disciplines.
So it sounds like another way that you could phrase this position might be applied skepticism. That is, through your you decide not to put a specific judgment, and so instead use the subject as a source of inquiry. Am I understanding that correctly?
Yeah. Applied skepticism, perhaps, but I think your second point I can certainly resonate with. The idea of philosophy as a mode of inquiry rather than as a means to some final certainty. And so in that sense, a kind of skepticism that never abates. And therefore also the notion of provisionality, the notion of even his own work in non-standard philosophy, he always holds to be kind of provisional. One of the things that's interesting in his project is that it's changed over the last 40 years. Some of the terms have changed. He's very much invested in not deciding on the real, but being self-critical in what concepts he's marshaling. And then the question is, you know, like, I should have said this earlier. I mean, one of the things he also wants to get away from is something he also sees in standard philosophy, which is, again, almost this idea that we can exchange a concept for the object in the practice of thought. Like, I'm talking about pictorialist photography, and then pictorialism becomes sort of exchangeable with, let's say, the capacious reality of a photograph by Julie Margaret Cameron. And it almost happens without us being aware of it. We start to talk that way, we use that discourse. He wants to break that and say, there's gotta be some gap he wants to hold open between any, say, concept in that case of photography and the photographic object in question. Always sort of hold apart the concept as being distinct and different from the reality of the photographic object. And this means that there's an interesting way in which his project is a kind of study in what he calls conceptual insufficiency. Always he wants to hold the concept is never sufficient to fully capture and close the object of inquiry. He does want us to get us away from what he would call that philosophical decision, that gesture of like, I've decided Dan Flavin is about post-minimalism. End of story. Here's the book about it. And so he does want to get us away from that. And you're right, there's elements of skepticism for sure in his work. There's elements of existentialism. This is to introduce another technical term. He'll use the term clones. A lot of his the terms and even the forms of argumentation in his text, he'll use the term clone to describe it, meaning it looks a lot like things like skepticism, for example, as you're noting, or things like existentialism, except because he's precisely using that stuff as material. He's happy to draw on those traditions for generating his non-standard philosophy. The difference is, unlike, say, an existentialist like Heidegger, he's not going to say that an existentialist discourse, an existentialist philosophy is going to unlock the secret of being. That is what he will not do. So he says, there's plenty of things we can harvest and resource out of someone like Heidegger or other existentialists, Sartre and so forth, but he doesn't think that any existentialism or any other philosophical school has in its conceptual toolbox the necessary resources to make the kind of decisions that they claim are within their reach about the nature of reality.
That was really interesting. I don't know if it's, maybe it's just me, but when it comes to anything with philosophy, I have to listen to it like 50 times and then, or read it 5 times or whatever. And then I was like, okay, maybe I'm fine now.
Yeah, I'm the same way. And so what is the relevance of the non or the term non-philosophy? Why this not? I mean, one of the things he developed that term non-philosophy, non-standard philosophy. And he's always said that one of the inspirations for it was non-Euclidean geometry, not because non-standard philosophy is sort of is mathematical or anything like that, but simply because in Euclidean geometry, parallel lines never meet. That's one of its axioms. It just follows from it. But in non-Euclidean geometry, where you're using curved space, parallel lines always meet, like the lines on a globe. And so non-standard philosophy, in some sense, is like a shift in perspective that's that kind of large. So it's just in the same sense that non-Euclidean geometry doesn't invalidate Euclidean geometry. It stands alongside it as meaningful in its own terms. So he analogizes that to non-standard philosophy. It doesn't invalidate philosophy. It stands beside it. and is, in his view, legitimate in its own terms, in its own axioms.
That's interesting. I mean, so it seems kind of like experiential learning. It's just kind of like, because I can see that, like, obviously, even, you know, maybe they're both just as confusing to me, but like, you could study philosophy and still study non-philosophy, you know, but I guess it would depend on, obviously, maybe personally, what you think is more effective. But yeah,
I would say, you know, I have to tell you, I should have told you this at the start, because it's, I think, revealing. The first book I ever read by Laruelle was The Concept of Non-Photography, because at the time I was writing my dissertation on 19th century photography. I thought, well, this is something interesting. I'll just see what this book's about. And some of my friends in this theory center were reading his work. I tried reading that thing. It's only about, I don't know, small book. And I almost threw it out. And I was so frustrated. I couldn't understand it. I thought this was mystificatory. I thought it was poorly argued. And yet I just kept coming back to it, and I kept underlining things. I just kept coming back. How can I possibly integrate this into anything like photography theory as I understood it? I tried to integrate it into my understanding of Bard and Sontag and so forth, and I couldn't do it. And finally, I just decided that the only way, I said, well, you know, I'll write a short book about it and get it out of my system. I'll try to understand it at this level. And then I got that book done, and I thought, I like it better, but I don't think I really understand it fully. And I talked to a colleague of mine who also works on Laruelle, and he said something that I totally resonate with. He said his work is like a stone. He said for him, it was like a stone in his shoe. It was slightly irritating, but he had to kind of keep working at it. And that would spend my experience as well. It's very hard. And so to your point about philosophy, non-philosophy, one of the things about non-standard philosophy is that I don't think that you have to have a lot of philosophy behind you to understand it, but it helps, because if you do, you begin to sort of see, oh yeah, like people like Zane was saying, there's a little bit of skepticism there, it's a little bit of existentialism there. And you can kind of see the traces of philosophical thought that are a sort of supporting, however, a project that he thinks is fundamentally different than any philosophy.
Okay, that's interesting. I mean, to be honest, the artist I'm probably most acquainted with is Barnett Newman. Mm-hmm. I love that guy. And like, the more I study him, and the more I'm like, he's nothing like the abstract expressionist. In some ways he is, obviously. But it's just like, I don't know. So
yeah, that's a great point, is, you know, I mean, you know, a lot of these terms are, oftentimes I find that they're very useful pedagogically as sort of placeholders. They kind of get us into a frame of reference. But you're right, then you get into the details of it and you think, well, geez, you know, there's a really very real and important difference between the abstract expressionism of a Jackson Pollock and a Barnett Newman. And it's not just in terms of their approach to painting, it's their whole like philosophy of what the point of painting is, what its role in the world is. I mean, yeah, I think it just reminded me too of there's a wonderful text by André Salmon on Cubism, which he was, you know, a contemporary of Picasso's. And in a short essay he wrote on Cubism at the very moment in which Cubism was just sort of emerging, Salmon says there's no such thing as Cubism. He's already saying that this is a kind of turn that's coming after the fact. There's nothing to do with what's actually happening in the work of people like Picasso and Braque. So somehow the history of Cubism has to also include André Salmon, who said that there was no such thing as Cubism. He was writing that in the early 20th century. And that those kind of paradoxes in art history I find really fascinating. And I find that approaches like Laruelle's helpful for navigating. What kind of work are we, is a term like Cubism being asked to do? And can it really capaciously sort of cover over or grasp what's happening in the painting of Picasso or Braque at that moment?
Not necessarily that philosophy doesn't, but would you say like non-philosophy pretty much begs to be more flexible pretty much with its interpretations and such?
Yeah, I mean, and I would certainly, but I'd also say that it, at least Laruelle, tends to eschew interpretation. So he doesn't want to use philosophy, even non-standard philosophy, as an interpretive tool. He doesn't want to give us, as it were, for example, in his essay on Terrell, from my reading, he doesn't give us an interpretation of Terrell like this is what Terrell's about, or this is the meaning of the work. Rather, he tries to model a philosophical thought on perception using Terrell as a point of departure. Yeah, he really resists doing the work of interpreting art in favor of thinking about what philosophy would look like from the perspective of art itself. In the book, in the Laruelle One art book, I try to develop that into something like, to put it in a kind of slogan form, not a philosophy of art, but an art of philosophy. And that this is the sort of reorientation.
How do you think this perspective prioritizes the way we experience art? Is it an aesthetic experience in an instant prioritized over our view of art history as a whole?
Very good question, very hard question. Laruelle is certainly very concerned with the question of experience. He's certainly concerned with aesthetic experience. What he prioritizes, though, unlike many in the tradition, is he prioritizes a kind of mode of aesthetic experience that is removed from the question of judgment. For example, Kant said in so many words that aesthetic experience was coterminous with aesthetic judgment. That when if I have a pleasant aesthetic experience, I say, what a lovely sunset, for example. Well, in some very real sense, what I've done is simply make a judgment. So for him, aesthetic experience, to the extent we're conscious of it, is always coterminous with a judgment about aesthetic experience. And put somewhat schematically, Laruelle wants to pull those things apart. Hold on to the aesthetic experience, but how can you but suspend judgment? So I say prioritizes the experience and deprioritizes the judgment. Very hard to do, but that's another mountain, I guess, in his mountain range. And I should also say too, it's not that he wouldn't also think that it's just all subjective and that we just all have our interpretations and go home. And in fact, again, one of the things he doesn't like is the way in which interpretation becomes a kind of locus of philosophical debate where I have the right interpretation, you have the wrong one. His interest is different. His interest is something like, this is a really interesting aesthetic experience. What would happen if I translated that into a philosophical form? And in that sense, or into a non-standard philosophical form, and in that sense, art becomes, again, a kind of point of departure for the generation of thought, rather than thought being the determining force that frames art and decides it or determines it or explains it.
Thank you so much. Really appreciate it. That was really interesting. Look, my book. My book actually just got here. So they just brought it in to me.
my publisher thanks you.